Alhamdulillah alladhi hadana li hadha wa ma kunna linahtadiya lawla an hadana Allah. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala sayyidina Muhammadin miftah bab rahmatillah. عادل ما في علم الله صراط وسلام دائم لدوام ملك الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه واشهد أنه الله الذي لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له إله واحد ورب شاهد ونحن له مسلمون واشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا وكرة عيننا محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله الله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله ولو كره المشركون أما بعد يا عباد الله إني موصيكم ونفسي إياي بتقوى الله الحمد لله الله سبحانه وتعالى has blessed us with his deen and has blessed us with his guidance through the Quran al-Kareem that he revealed to the heart of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as he informed us in the Quran that he revealed this Quran upon the heart, the qalb of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Prophet bore this revelation, and that he conveyed the revelation sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the Sadat and the Sahaba, and he left us with guidance in every time and in every place, and that he reached the highest level of nasiha, of true sincere advice to his ummah. His ummah not only in his time, but the ummah until Yawm al-Qiyamah. That there is no good except that he told us about that good sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and there is no evil except that he warned us about that evil sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Is that this is one of the great miracles of the life of these short 23 years that he spent as a prophet. After receiving prophecy, these years whereby which that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears in the Quran, la amruka innahum lafi sakratihim ya'mahoon. That he swears by the lifespan of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because in this blessed 23 years that we have guidance that was not only for his time sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is that we have in it guidance for every single time. And this was the essential mission of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Innama bu'ithtu mu'allima, is that I've only been sent as a teacher. Every single act of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a teaching. His movements were a teaching. His stillness was a teaching sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His times of silence was teaching. When he was standing, he was teaching. When he was sitting, when he was teaching. When he was traveling, he was teaching. When he was at home, he was teaching. When he was with his companions, he was teaching. Every single moment of his life sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a teaching. And that the Sahaba had various degrees into which that they understood that. They had various degrees into which that they tapped into an understanding of who exactly the Prophet was sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Far from being a very disaffected type distant relationship, that they had a very intimate and close relationship with Rasulullah. And that they saw is that there was something about their relationship with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that directly related to the relationship of their deen. Is that they recognize, is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that yes, he was a human being, but he was not like other human beings. That he received revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is that yes, قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشُرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ, say that indeed that I am a human being like you, yuha ilay. But I receive revelation, yuha ilay. I receive revelation, أَنَّمَا إِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهٌ وَاحَدٌ, that indeed that your Lord is one Lord. And the foundational meaning of all revelation and all of the branch meanings stem from our understanding of Tawheed, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam not only had Tawheed in terms of belief, but he had Tawheed in the various degrees of Tawheed, such that everything that he did in reality was a reflection and experiential realities of the way he was experiencing that Tawheed. This is why that we have Tawheed with the lisan, but we also have Tawheed that pertains to everything that we do. Because that if we believe that Allah Ta'ala has the 99 beautiful names, and we attribute all of these great traits and qualities and attributes to our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the way that we then interact with the world, that we could have our actions belie what we believe deep down in our hearts. That we be, when we move up to the higher degrees of Tawheed, where we have an experiential type of iman, this is at the very essence of our deen. This deen did not come just so that merely we could memorize words on paper. This deen came so that you and I become transformed human beings. Is that we can change into people that even though that they're here on this earth, صاحب الدنيا بأبداني وقلوبهم معلقة بالمال الأعلى, as Imam Ali bin Abi Talib said to Kumail when he asked him about who were the ulama al-amineen. And he said to him, هجب بهم على حقيقة الأمر, is that these are people that knowledge rushed them to the reality of affairs. Fabashir ruha yaqeen, that they were able to experience and feel the spirit of certainty. Sahib al-dunya bi abdanihi, yes, they existed in this world with their physical bodies. Wa qulubuhum mu'alliqatun bi mal al-a'la, but their hearts were attached to the higher celestial realms. They were attached to the meanings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows upon the elect of his creation. And our Lord teaches us, subhanahu wa ta'ala, through the sunnah of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that even though that we are here on this earth, is that oftentimes human beings can become very petty. But we have not been created to be petty. We have not been created in vain. We've been created for a purpose that transcends any of these things that happen on this plenary realm. Is it how many human beings have existed from the first of creation, from Adam alayhi salam until now? How many human beings have existed? And what has happened in all of these various examples of human history until this day and age? And that how many people, all of these people that have existed until now, have understood the importance of the whole purpose for which they were created, which is to know their Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of the most important aspects of this guidance of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pertains to having direction in times where many people are confused. Having direction in times where many people are confused. And one of the greatest blessings of this guidance that our Prophet gave us is that there's certain things that you can latch onto in any given time. As difficult as the time becomes, as confusing as the time becomes, is that you can have a perspective whereby which these things you're absolutely certain about and thus focus on them, and then from that basis that you then analyze and look out. That if we have grounding, that we are centered people, is that we have a centering. And this is one of the greatest blessings because the modern man does not have any center. And thus it leads to all different types of chaos. We are centered. We understand what human beings' purpose is here on earth. Is that we understand how human beings relate to the Lord. We understand the relationship between the cosmos and man. And how all of these things pertain to the whole reason that we were created. We still understand this. And we still have traditions that have been extended into this time. Where all of these great fruits that come from establishing a connection to our Lord and to our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that they appear within the human being. They still exist amongst us. And this is one of the great miracles of this deen that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam left with us. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he gave us his guidance. Allah ta'ala mentions in the Quran, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu la yadhurrukum man dhalla idha ihtadaytum ila Allahi marji'ukum jami'an fayunabbi'ukum bima kuntum ta'malun. He said, oh you who believe, that alaykum anfusukum, that stick to your own selves, adhere to your own selves. And perhaps in light of all of these tribulations that are happening right now, someone will bring to mind that how are you going to say stick to your own self when all of these things are happening in the ummah of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Well, there's a hadith that we should all be aware of, that our Prophet told us sallallahu alaihi wasallam, fitanun qatta ala al-mudhlim. Indeed, just before the hour, there will be tribulations and trials like the successive darkness of night. Every little piece of night that comes, it gets darker than the moment that comes before it. And he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is he said that al-qa'idu fiha khayrun min al-qa'im, is that the one sitting is better than the one standing. Wal-qa'imu fiha khayrun min al-mashi, the one standing is better than the one walking. Wal-mashi fiha khayrun min al-sa'i, and the one walking is better than the one running into them. And what is understood from this is that at times where there is murky waters that we don't understand, is that our Prophet is teaching us, yes, there is certain times where you have to refrain from getting involved in tribulations. Because if you get involved in those tribulations, like if you drop your keys in water and there's mud at the bottom of that water and you reach in too quickly, is that you might murky up the water and have less chance of getting your keys. There's times where things are unclear. And our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is giving us guidance. And this is a hadith related by Imam Ahmed. It's also related by Imam Dawood. But he goes on to say, he says, فَكَسِرُوا قَصِيُّكُمْ, break your bows, وَقَطِّيُوا أَوْتَارَكُمْ, and the strings. And he says, وَضْلِبُوا سُيُوفُكُمْ بِالْحِجَارَةِ, break your swords on rocks. And دُخِلَ أَحَدِكُمْ, if someone enters in your house, بَيْتُهُ فَيَكُمْ كَخَيْرِ ابْنِ آدَمَ, if someone enters into your home, even to take your life, then be the better of the two sons of Adam. Cain killed Abel. Be like Abel. Be like the better two sons of Adam. Why was it that Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan, this is fahm, this is understanding of deen. Why was it that when his house was surrounded, is that some of the companions, the two sons of Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, what shows is that the way that the Sahaba viewed one another. Yes, Sayyidina Hassan and Sayyidina Hussein, they were ready to shed their swords and defend Sayyidina Uthman. And he said, leave them. Leave them. And he went in a state and he started reading Quran. And he was murdered and martyred as he's reading the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and someone entered into his home. He didn't even fight back. Why did he do that? He was a man, hashalillah. All of the Sahaba were men. But he had fahm, he had understanding of the deen. And that oftentimes that we find is that when you take knowledge from books, is that you're not able to apply that knowledge in the appropriate way. When you take knowledge from the internet, when you take knowledge from sources that are not true sources of how we learn as believers, because the foundational part of our tradition is an oral tradition. Yes, that we have a written aspect that buttresses the oral tradition, but the foundation is that we have an oral tradition. And that oral tradition has been passed down generation after generation. These are people that have taken this deen seriously, and that they've passed it down, and that they help us to have the proper mawaqif in the way that we stand and understand and read reality and thus respond to it accordingly. So our Prophet is teaching us about this, is that the foundational aspect of the deen that we rely upon in any particular time is your own self. You are primarily concerned about your own self and how that you are going to rectify your own self. And if you are helping other people to the extent of the detriment of your own self, you're not following the guidance of the Quran. Because the Quran, our Lord is teaching us, subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَا يَضُرُّكُمْ مَنْ ضَلَّ إِذَا هَدَيْتُمْ. It will not harm you, is that if you are guided when other people go astray. And that there's a difference of opinion about the sabab of nuzul, the occasion of the revelation of this particular verse. One of them says that the Muslims, is that they were eager to be able to call other people to Islam. And when they found when some people weren't responding, this was revealed in order for them to make them firm that yes, even though they're not responding to your call, that it doesn't harm you and stick to what you're doing. But the opposite, there's another opposite opinion as well, is that those that were then criticizing and reviling the Sahaba for calling the other people in the community in Mecca to guidance, is that it became difficult for them, so this brought them solace and understanding. Is that yes, even though is that you in people's eyes are lowly people, and that there's people that are trying to take you away upon the guidance you're upon, that stick to this because la yaghurrukum min dhallaytum ila ihtadaytum. Is that it will not harm you those that go astray, that if you yourself are guided. And then we find an amazing hadith about this. Is that one of the Sahaba was asked about what this means, that alaykum anfusukum. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq said one time he got up on the minbar, and then he said, just for clarity so that people don't think that we mean like this, is that you just don't actively are involved in just causes. He said, he got up on the minbar and he said, and he quoted this verse. He says, "Zayyafarannakum." Don't be deluded by those who quote this verse and try to be a means for you not to do amr bin ma'roof wa nahy anil munkar. He says, "For wallahi, that you will indeed do amr bin ma'roof and nahy anil munkar, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will subjugate you to people that will cause great problems for you." But Ibn Mas'ud then comments upon this. He says, "This verse is not the verse for your time." And he's speaking to the companions. This verse is not the verse of your time, because the way that the companions were is that they loved truth so much and they were living truth that they couldn't be silent when they saw wrong. Is that they spoke out against it immediately. But Ibn Mas'ud understand that there will come a time, is that this will be the case. And what was his guidance in those times? As he says, is that when that you speak to people and you feel that they benefit from what you're saying and they accept it, he says, then do it. He says, but if not, this is where this verse applies. Is that when you're in a time where things become so confusing, is that even very intelligent, forbearing people, that they become confused. That is different than the time when things are clear. And that the time in which we live is the most confusing time in history. We live in the most confusing time in history, and if you don't believe that, you haven't read enough to understand. What is really the state of the time in which we live? Really, to properly make a decision when we wait to these grand affairs on an individual basis, that's something else, and this is the heart of what we're trying to get at, is that the platform whereby which we interact with all of these difficult circumstances of our time is a platform for recognizing that the most important thing of all is your own state with your Lord. And the greatest way for you to bring change ultimately to not only your family and beyond that, your neighbors and your local community and thus the Ummah of our Prophet ﷺ, is by beginning sticking with that unchanging principle of focusing upon the transformative nature of this relation and this deen in relation to your own self. And so, that having said that, that this companion said that he was asked about what this meant, عَلَيْكُمْ أَنْفُسُكُمْ, that stick to yourselves. And he said that indeed that I asked خَبِيرًا, I asked someone that was of great knowledge. What he meant by that, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And he asked the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم about this, and the Prophet said, بَلِتْمِ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَنْهُوا عَنْ وَتَنَاهُوا عَنِ الْمُنْكُرِ, call to good. And he said, and forbid evil, حَتَّى إِذَا رَيْتَ الشُّحَّ الْمُطَاعٍ وَهَوَى الْمُتَّبَعٍ وَإِجَابَ كُلِّ ذِي مَرْءٍ بِرَأْيِهِ, until that you find is that people are just following their desires, and that they are that hawan muttaban, and that they're just following the greed of their own souls. They're following the desires for dunya muqtaratan, and that they are just preferring worldly things. And that everyone is impressed with their own opinion. And what did our Prophet say? فَعَلَيْكَ بِنَفْسِكَ, that stick to your own self. This is the guidance of Rasulullah. فَعَلَيْكَ بِنَفْسِكَ. How else are you going to translate that? Meaning that the Prophet wouldn't have said this were there not going to be a time whereby this was going to be a reality, where things were going to become so confusing people weren't going to know what to do. What did our Prophet say? فَعَلَيْكَ بِنَفْسِكَ, that stick to your own self. وَإِنَّ مِنْ وَرَائِكُمْ أَيَامَ الصَّبْرِ, indeed there is coming at times that are going to be times of patience. الصَّبْرِ فِيهِ مَثْلُ قَبْضٍ عَلَى الْجَمَرِ, being patient in it is like holding on to a hot coal. لِلْعَامِلِ فِيهِمْ مِثْلَ أَجْرِ خَمْسِينَ رَجُلٍ يَعْمَلُونَ مِثْلَ عَمَلِهِ, he's speaking to the Sahaba. The one who does good deeds in this time is like someone who does, is like someone who has the reward of 50 of the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that this is a time, there's a hadith in Sahih Muslim where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, الْعِبَادَةُ فِي الْحَرْجِ كَهِجْرَةٍ إِلَيْهِ, is that worshipping Allah Ta'ala in times of indiscriminate killing is like migrating to me. What was the rank of the Muhajireen that migrated from Mecca and Mukarramah and migrated all the way into Medina and Murawara for the sake of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala? Allah Ta'ala mentions about the Muhajireen and the Ansar. And everything our Prophet is saying is that you can share in this meaning of hijrah to the Prophet if you're living in one of these times. As he says, كَهِجْرَةٍ إِلَيْهِ, that worshipping Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala in a time of harsh, of indiscriminate killing where things are totally crazy. He says, in this particular time, it's like migrating unto me. In other words, if we give a more deeper analysis to this hadith, is that in times of confusion, where things have become crazy, where people have made what is branching certain things that you do in the rarest of circumstances, the usul of the foundation, is that when this confusion is there, and you focus upon what you're supposed to be focused on, which is upon your own self, first and foremost, and by extension other people, is that you sticking to your principles in this time is your struggle with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet gave us this guidance, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why did he say, مَنْ تَمَسَّكَ بِأُمَّتِي عَنْدَ فَسَادِ أُمَّتِي, in the narration of Al-Bayhaqi, فَلَوْ أَجْرَ مِيَتْ شَهِيدٍ, another narration shaheed, but in the riwayah of Bayhaqi, فَلَوْ أَجْرَ مِيَتْ شَهِيدٍ, whoever sticks firmly to my sunnah, when my ummah becomes corrupted, is that he will have the reward of 100 martyrs. 100 martyrs from sticking to the sunnah of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And then when you think about the sunnah of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what does that mean? People have restricted that to a merely outward observance of the sunnah. Yes, this is extremely important. That all of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are great. Outward sunnahs and inward sunnahs. But the greatest sunnahs that have been neglected are the inward sunnahs of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The sunnah al-kubra, the great sunnah, the greatest of all sunnah that pertain to detaching your heart from the love of this world. That's one of the greatest sunnahs of the Prophet of all. Is to be a person who is not attached to this world. And to be a person that is separated from their hearts, that all of these normal ways that human beings interact with this world and such that they desire more what Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala has in store for the next world. Because if you look at death from this perspective, as the Prophet taught us, Al-Mawtu Tuhfat al-Mu'min, there's a hadith that states this, is that death is the gift of the believer. But this is a believer. Why is it a mu'min? Because he's someone that realizes what Allah has in store for the believers, Yawm al-Qiyamah. What He has in store for them as they move across the Sirat, and as they go to the Hawd of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, as they enter into the various degrees of paradise, is greater. Walil akhiru khayrun wa abqa. Indeed, the next world is good and is what is greater and even more everlasting. Is that when we take this into consideration, is that there are the ultimate sunnahs of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Is that these are the focus in any particular time. And someone that becomes blinded by their time, by through their time, that prevents them from implementing this aspect of the sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, is that we find, is that what happens is that they themselves want to do good, but because of a lack of wisdom, they end up actually causing more harm than they do benefit. So our Prophet gave us that this guidance, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this verse finishes after Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, لَا يَضُرُّكُمْ مَنْ ضَلَّ يَهْتَدَيْتُمْ إِلَى اللَّهِ مَرْجِعُكُمْ جَمِيعًا. That all of you are going to return to Allah. فَيُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. And that He will surely let you know that everything that you used to do, all of these things that become confusing now, يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ, there's no confusion. Everything is clear, يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ. Why this happened, why this person did what he did, then what was the result of this, what was the real intention behind this, there will be no confusion, Yawm al-Qiyamah. And if we may at this point, let's end by saying that this whole idea of theodicy and the problem of evil and so forth, is that the reality that this is a type of nonsense of human beings to think that they can somehow understand that all of the reasons and wisdoms why certain things happen to other people. It says that if you look at things from the grand perspective in someone in their own particular life, and you don't understand everything that's gone into the everything from the background of this individual such that it then allows them or is it means for them to do what they're doing in that moment, that you won't be able to make a decision, a rational decision, if whether they deserved what came to them or not. Is in other words, is that there's a lot of mysteries that pertains to human beings. And that knowing that when everything is revealed on Yawm al-Qiyamah, that you will see that everything that happened to every single person, as of what the poet said, that Ataqara bi jazeer wa kullu fi'lak jameel, is that your gifts are great, O Lord, wa kullu fi'lak jameel. Every act of God ultimately is beauty. How could it be other than beauty? As difficult as it is for me to say this as people that are lounging and basking in the beautiful weather of California in the spring in Pleasanton, is that every act of God is beautiful. Every tajalli, manifestation of His beautiful name or His majestic name, tabaraka wa ta'ala, ultimately is beautiful because it is a tajalli of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then if we can get beyond that and start to understand, is that there's wisdoms and why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does what He does, and everyone in the end gets what they deserve, and He gives His bounty to whom He pleases. To whom He pleases, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us to be from the elect of those who receive His bounty. وَقُولُوا قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ لِجَمِيعِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ إِنَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen wa sallallahu ala Sayyidina Muhammadin ashraf al-anbiya al-mursaleen wa ala alihi al-tayyibin al-tahirin wa sahabil al-akramin wa tabi'in innahum ihsan ila yawm al-deen. وأشهد أن الله الذي لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا محمد عبده ورسوله. أما بعد يا عباد الله إني موصيكم ونفسي إياي بتقوى الله. Alhamdulillah, that the wisdom why we come by together on this blessed day of Jummah is to revive these great meanings of the deens in our hearts. Is that we are in need of a renewal of our deen. Is that Allah Ta'ala informed us that every 100 years, that ala raqs kudi simiyat sana, that Allah Ta'ala will send someone whereby which they will revive the deen of our Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and they will renew it. But also that we need to go through these other types of renewal. Our Prophet told us, jaddidu imanakum, renew your faith. بأكثر من قول لا إله إلا الله. Say often لا إله إلا الله. Say often, La ilaha illa. Akthiru min qawli La ilaha illallah. Every time you say La ilaha illallah, you renew your faith. And you say it twice, you renew your faith twice. If you say it 100 times, you renew it even more than that. We should be people who say La ilaha illallah constantly. La ilaha illallah constantly. And you die upon the way that you live. If you get used to saying La ilaha illallah now while we're here in this world, is that it will be a means for you when we take our last breath to say La ilaha illallah. This is the most precious statement and word of all that Allah Ta'ala has given in all of creation. And one of the meanings behind La ilaha illallah that goes along with that is the belief that we have about our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The essence of this deen is a deen of mahabbah. So if we're going to talk about one of the main things whereby which is that we have this istiqamah and uprightness upon the path, and we perform the obligations, and we do the sunnah of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we learn what we need to learn, we give people the rights, and all other aspects of our deen, is that the difference between a heart who does all of that that's filled with love, and between someone who does all of those things that's not filled with love, is the difference between the heavens and the earth. Is that love is at the very essence of this entire deen. The Quran begins, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, and the essence of Rahmah is love. And this is why that the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that they understood that. They loved the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The companion came to Rasulullah, he says, Ya Rasulullah, wallahi inni la uhibbuk. He said, Ya Messenger of Allah, by Allah indeed that I love you. And what did our Prophet say? Undur ma taqul. Look at what you're saying. Look at what you're saying. And he said, Ya Rasulullah, I love you. And the Prophet went on to say, he says that indeed is that those who love me is that poverty will come to them extremely quickly. Poverty will hasten to them really quickly. Okay, my Qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in other words, is that if you truly love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that your life will be filled with tribulations. And you will find you will have difficult times, but is that if that love is there, is that those tribulations will become sweet. In other words, what our Prophet is teaching us sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that the primary way that we deal with any tribulations is by putting its opposite. You put water on fire to quell it. Meaning is that if you can approach all of the tribulations of any time with love of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that it will put out that fire. And meaning that even though poverty would come to you, even all other types of tribulations will come to you, if you have love in your heart, is that you will stay through those tribulations unaffected. And in fact that you will grow, and that you will then attain great ranks from the way that you stuck to the guidance of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in those difficult times, and you will be from those people that our Prophet referred to have the reward of Mi'at Shaheed. You will be from those people that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that he longed for. There's several narrations. One of them is the Prophet says, I long for my brothers. And another narration, I love my brothers. One of them says, Wadidtu. Another one says, every single member of the Ummah of the Prophet is beloved to him. And that when you deal with that individual Muslim brother of yours, understanding is that Rasulullah longs to him. If you are conscious of that, when you interacted with your brother Muslim, how would you treat him? That, oh, the way that this person is, that if you're conscious that Rasulullah longs to be with him, how would you treat him? How would you treat someone that you know Rasulullah longs to be with that particular person? You would respect them and you would honor them, and things would be completely opposite. One of the funniest things, it's not funny actually, is that you'll see people that even in the masjid speak and frown to their brothers and mistreat them. Is that if they're on the phone with their kafir boss, they're, oh, yes, sir, how are you doing? And they speak very respectfully and they have good posture and they speak, you know, an American version of Queen's English, and they think that you're speaking to your Muslim brother in a way and you think that you can just mistreat him, but your kafir boss that you speak to in a way as if he's your sayyidah, ishara. That your believers, the believers, are more worthy of you having humility towards them and speaking to them in a respectful way. Is that we cannot do what we want to do unless we come together as an ummah. What did our Prophet say? What did Allah Ta'ala teach us? That فَلَا تَنَازُوا فَتَفْشَلُوا فَلَا تَنَازُوا فَتَفْشَلُوا وَتَهَذْهَبَ رِيحُكُمْ. There's no way to be given victory if we are not joined as an ummah. Do not differ with one another. فَتَفْشَلُوا. Thus you will fail and your victory will be gone. You'll be taken from you. There's no way to be given victory if we do not come together as an ummah. And that we don't have that bond of brotherhood and sisterhood, that the basis of which is love for Allah and His Messenger. This is the secret of all success for the ummah of our Prophet ﷺ. And that you can begin that by doing things very simple. Very, very, very simple. Afshu salam. They spread peace. Watimut ta'am. That feed people. Silul arham. That join your family ties. Wasallu fil layl wa nas niyam. Pray at night when other people are sleeping. What's the result? Tadkhul al-jannah bis-salam. You enter into paradise peacefully. Not difficulty, not ever. Bis-salam. Enter into paradise peacefully. Islam is very simple. Islam is very simple. This deen, if you build it upon its foundations, is very simple. What is important, though, is that we actualize its realities. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما صليت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما باركت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد ورضي الله تعالى عن سادة الخلفاء الراشدين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وجميع سادة الصحابة الكرام وجميع أهل بيت رسول الله المطهرين من الأرجاس وعلينا معهم وفيهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين وعلينا معهم وفيهم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم أعز الإسلام وانصر المسلمين اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات المسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات ربنا تقبل منا انك انت السميع العليم وتوب علينا انك انت التواب الرحيم يا اول الاولين يا اخر الاخرين يا ذا القوة المتين ويا رحم المساكين ويا ارحم الراحمين انجزنا رحمة من عندك نسعد بها في الدنيا والاخرة May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq in all of our affairs and strengthen the bond of brotherhood between us. May Allah ta'ala bless us to be people of akhirah and work for the akhirah. Give us tawfiq in all of our affairs. Bless our hearts to be filled with the light of guidance of Rasulullah, to live and die upon the realities of the Rasul, the deen of Rasulullah, where we have complete steadfastness and firmness upon this path, and all be gathered together in the highest levels of paradise after a long life in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And may all of us say as we exit this dunya, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, completely actualizing its realities inwardly and outwardly. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم واشكروا عليه يزدكم ولذكر الله